Hello, our friends, Evolutionary Energy Arts family.
Hello there, we're back.
We're back. And so are more fireballs, meteors, great balls of fire, whatever they may be.
There's something for sure, yep.
So here we see a spectacular bright green meteor fireball disintegrates across southeast Australia from Tasmania to New South Wales and goes and explodes over Melbourne. Isn't that wild? I mean, we've had so many fireballs.
I know, and on Valentine's Day, too. I think it's cool.
Happy Valentine's Day, by the way, everybody.
Hey, happy Valentine's Day.
So, OMG, oh my God, this was a spectacular fireball. And did you see it in Australia? So interesting. You could see it coming in. It looks like it's going to take the city out, sort of by the video, and then just...
Kind of apocalyptic.
It's crazy. It's crazy what we have going on all over. You can see the area where people had seen it mostly. By the way, we also had one up in the UK and Western Europe. As you can see, a lot of people saw that one too.
I like how they have the little guys on the map. It's cute.
Oh, man. That reminds me of playing Stratego. Do you guys remember Stratego?
No, but I remember Candyland, and it kind of had that sort of...
Well, we did get Risk, if you guys remember Risk. We bought that for when the power goes out. We're just going to play Risk.
And we're going to have fun at it, too.
We have this other game. What is it called? It's just
Conspiracy. It's called Conspiracy.
Yeah, we haven't broke that out, but that's going to be a real fun one. Maybe later on.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you know, fireballs are continuing. There's a lot of video for you guys to see. We have another one coming in close, 0.07 a lunar distance. This is CW7. And thankfully, this one's, you know, only at most about 12 feet across. So it might just be another brilliant fireball somebody sees in the sky. But there's been a lot of these. It's still picking up. It seems like it's just increasing. Pretty wild.
Mm-hmm. I know, like every day, every other day. Yep.
As you can see, the flybys so far... Just this year.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, maybe there is something to Nibiru Planet X. We shall see. Or maybe it's just, you know, Enlil's suns just throwing things our way.
It could be a little of both.
Yeah, I like that both. So most definitely we have anomalous winter storms worldwide. Moscow was hit by the worst snowfall in decades. Snow record in Seattle. Greece's beautiful beaches are all covered in white. As Europe is getting buried, but, you know, wait until the Gulf Stream stops. Oh, boy.
Everything is already so cold.
A snowfall this intense hasn't been registered in Moscow for 50 years. Current record dating back to 1973. Of course, you know, look at how buried these cars are.
That's pretty deep.
It's a good thing they knew where they were parked.
I know. Then there's that.
Yeah, which leads to a lot of dangerous travel, most definitely. I mean, just look at what we saw in Texas.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're thinking about heading out to warmer weather. Well, maybe a couple degrees. You know, in the near future, it will probably be traveling in some snow and some ice. Mm-hmm. Major snow and ice storm hits the Pacific Northwest. Snow in Greece. Now, it was unseasonably warm for a while, but, you know, that has changed quickly, but people are enjoying it and having snowball fights.
Yes, and if you can, stay home and stay warm and maybe just play in the front yard.
Yeah, we took Sassy and Zeke out for a walk, and, you know, it's kind of wild watching Sassy. It's like, you see her, she jumps up, and then boom, where'd she go? Where'd she go? Oh, there she is. She jumps up again.
She's funny like that.
So, yeah, record low February temps across the UK. Look at some of these temps. -21.3 Celsius up there in Scotland. Woof. Yeah, Edinburgh, -13. We got some records falling everywhere, and we have, unfortunately, a lot of avalanches. So you have a pair of avalanches that killed 3 mountain climbers in Slovenia.
That's really sad.
There's been a bunch of those globally. Over 30 fatalities reported after weeks of flooding in South Africa. You know, we've been doing a lot of research trying to decide where we want to go. And every time we look at an area, you could find a dozen reasons not to go to any area, any area. You know, as we were saying, we follow some people that are doing the total off-grid thing down in Cochise County, Arizona, and they ran out of water. They have massive amounts of tanks. I mean, they could store like at least 50,000 gallons of water, and they ran out because there is a major drought in the West. It's going to lead to more wildfires. But then when you look to, say, all the Gulf Coast, you know, Florida through Texas, you know, was record year for hurricanes. That was crazy. Hurricanes, tropical storms were through the roof. Tornadoes, too. And then tornadoes are shifting. And, you know, Tornado Alley is shifting a little bit more east. We were going back a few years. The storms have picked up, guys. Oh, they have picked up. There's no way around that.
Yeah, that was interesting going back year by year by year. It was kind of, in a way, morbidly exciting to say, hey, go back a year. What does that look like? And there was less and less and less. It's definitely a marked difference.
You could see it coinciding to a degree with the sun, you know, because you'll see peaks around these same time frames going by sun cycle. But there's another component that I think the majority of you have picked up on, as we were talking about in the last video there, all the patents, mm-hmm. You know. Increased activity at Canalon Volcano in the Philippines. It just seems like there's so many volcanoes that are going to be exploding at the same time.
It does, and we got that too.
Well, that will lead to more cooling.
Yeah.
And tell me why they're building a tunnel right next to Stonehenge. You know, they are, by the way. They're building a tunnel right next to Stonehenge, which has got a lot of people upset. Notably, I mean, this is just such an iconic place. It's a piece of our history. So, you know, in preparations there and doing some digging, they found some ancient graves and mysterious enclosure over there as well. And of course, Stonehenge has a lot of people interested in it. There's other places around the globe that are kind of similar as well.
Yeah, that was interesting. And the word sacrifice came to me when I was looking at this. Kind of creepy.
So archaeological work ahead of construction of a controversial road tunnel next to Stonehenge has led to the discovery of ancient graves, including one with the remains of a baby, dating back more than 4,500 years, a strange earth enclosure, and prehistoric pottery, among other buried treasures. Some of the finds may have been used by people who built the mysterious Neolithic monument, and all the discoveries show that the region was inhabited by different ancient peoples for thousands of years. Collectively, the find allows us to build up an ever more detailed picture of what people were doing and how they were living in the area around Stonehenge. Before breaking ground on the $2.4 billion project, that's where they'd be, to move a nearby highway underground, UK authorities have tasked Wessex Archaeology with making a thorough investigation of the land above it. To do this, archaeologists walked the fields and created trenches and pits to test for archaeological remains and artifacts along a 2-mile, 3-kilometer strip where the road tunnel is planned. Yeah, I gotta think too. It's just me. It's a suspicious nature. I kind of wonder if they want to just kind of ruin some things, mm-hmm. You know, at the same time.
Well, it's such a powerful energetic hub that can do a lot.
As we've talked about, too, and I've got half a dozen friends that served over in Iraq, for instance, that spoke about these old sites that they would come on and they would be told to wipe them out. Wipe them out. I mean, that's our history. Why are you wiping out our history?
Yep, I've heard that too.
Tell us the truth. You know, tell us, David, they're not going to tell us the truth. I know. That's a stretch. But they found graves, including a baby and other remains. These people used to, well, they're called beaker graves because they used to bury the dead in bell-shaped pottery, like drinking vessels. And so these people lived in Western Europe between 4,800 and 3,800 years ago. So interesting what we see here. And this is kind of a representation there. And so you were getting that this is more like a sacrifice type thing.
Yeah, that's what came to mind. And I saw it was a 20-year-old woman, and maybe that's about the right age and a great sacrifice.
The archaeologists found a pattern of buried ditches south of the graves that appears to form an enclosure. Seems to date from a period in the middle to late Bronze Age, after about 3,500 years ago, where there was a settlement nearby. And one of the things that I find really interesting is, of course, you know, technologically, if you look at the construction of things, you know, it's rudimentary in many ways. Yet again, you always wonder, how can they move such big stones? But the knowledge, as far as astrologically, astronomically, was very, very precise. You know, there's like leftover knowledge. You wonder, you know, did some of the knowledge deteriorate as we have, you know, gone from a more golden age, more enlightened age with much higher tech, but yet tech that seemed in harmony with nature in many ways, not like now. And, you know, just like when you look at the ruins down in South America, the older you go, the more advanced they are.
I know. So we are definitely not the pinnacle of modern society now.
Not at all. Not at all. And, you know, here's again, just in my mind, I don't like the idea of disturbing these type of things. Do we really have to? Eerie figures with huge heads found painted in a rock shelter in Tanzania. And so they say that these pictures are hundreds of years old. They're not saying thousands, but hundreds. But the question is, why are they turning these people into melon heads?
Yeah, I know. That does seem a little awkward.
You know, what's going on here? Are they wearing some crazy headdresses, or are they trying to say that they saw some beings that were humanoid but not human?
That's what I'm thinking there, yeah.
Yeah, so this is yet another one. I mean, but we've seen some that look exactly like grays, mm-hmm, in all over the world, and also ones that look very reptilian, nursing babies, mm-hmm, or reptilian little babies, yeah, or hybrids.
Yeah, I'm also looking at these, and I feel like is there some kind of a laser pen to get these pictures in there? It's real curious how those are on the rock.
It is curious. You know, our history is just so obscured. Very, very obscured and purposely. By the way, European beads found in Alaska predate Columbus and probably came from Venice in Alaska.
Oh, how could that be possible? Our history says it's not so.
Right. You know, after all, you know, before Columbus, there was nothing in the Americas. You could tell that to the 75 to 100 million inhabitants.
Yeah, then there's that.
Well, that were there.
Yeah, that's sad.
Yeah, you know, just crazy. And now I look back at everything that we were taught as kids, you know, and growing up in the 70s, going to school in the 70s and the 80s. And it's just like everything has been redacted, as we've talked about, you know, and changed. We know better now. The stuff they were telling us was just all completely, completely off.
I know. And, you know, we have to keep looking back at the school books to know how far was it off. Is it off? It's way off.
Did you guys watch the Vikings show? If you guys watch Vikings at all, and I hope I don't give anything away if you didn't see the last season, but like a group of them first establish an outpost in Iceland and then some push on to Canada. And, you know, Floki, the Native Americans took care of him. He was one of the main characters, kind of a crazy shamanistic guy, who the natives called him the crazy man. Then when another group of Vikings come in, they take him to the crazy man. Mm-hmm. And I think they're, you know, insinuating again, you know, that there's a lot more to our history than we know. Do you know that in Oklahoma, supposedly there's ruins of what the Vikings had brought, some runes. And yeah, you know, I should do a show on that as well. I've been meaning to.
I know our history is completely covered up.
Yeah, and then there's the whole line of thought that really all these, well, what we think of as, you know, the Caucasus race, the race that supposedly comes from the Caucasus Mountains, Caucasians, perhaps it's really more leftover Cro-Magnon, which might be a remnant of Atlanteans.
Mm-hmm. I believe that. That feels right.
Yeah, that feels pretty interesting. Because when you look at it on the origin of the species here, they're telling us now, you know, don't get your hopes up for finding that missing link, that single missing link where you can say, okay, here it is. It was in East Africa. It was in Somalia. It was, you know, and it was at this time point, 350 or 2 million, you know, 350,000, 2 million, whatever they want to give us as far as numbers, that Homo sapiens all of a sudden popped into being. Instead, you know, they're telling us now there's probably multiple places that they sprouted into being. Okay. Well, did it have to do with a big cycle like we're in now? Because there are genetic mutations going on. We're finding new species all the time now. You remember the whale, the new whale species? There's been so many other new species that have been popping up. And, you know, Robert Felix, who wrote Not by Fire but by Ice, talking about the ice age that's coming, he also wrote about these times, you know, great grand solar minimums, pole reversals, which we are in, and genetic mutation, DNA mutations, leading to most of the species, 70-80% or better, disappearing, and then brand new ones just popping up out of nowhere.
Right. And I like one of the vocabularies they use in this ad is our complex history.
Right. Yeah. So they tell us, you know, it's not so simple looking for just one spot where Homo sapiens sapiens pops up. You know, you got to recognize now that we have complex origins.
Yes.
So do they want to tell us that, you know, there's advanced Atlanteans that intermingled, or that there's ETs that came down and intermingled, you know, whatever language we want to use, you know, the Watchers and Nephilim, the Anunnaki, all of the above.
Well, that's what I got just looking at those two vocabulary words, is they're saying a lot more now.
You know, the worldwide expansion of modern humans, 40 to 60,000 years ago. Well, okay, so that 40 to 60,000 makes me think of the 75,000-year cycle spoken of in the Law of One, which, you know, in the bigger cycle, it's been 75,000 years according to the Law of One, if you guys believe in the Law of One, which there's a lot of good information in there. There really is.
There really is.
There's a lot of stuff that just feels like it's pretty right on.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
So, and the last known contacts with the archaic groups, such as Neanderthals and Denisovans, of which some of us have their DNA, I think I'm 2.something% Neanderthal is as far as my personal breakdown. And then also, where, you know, there's the out of Africa theory, but what they're saying here is it might not just be out of Africa. It could be out of Africa. Could be out of India, could be out of Southeast Asia.
I know. They kind of keep expanding things here.
So when we hear of the couple hundred watchers to make a pact and descend down, and, you know, just think about it in those terms. If they had a little bit of, you know, ego, and if they wanted to have their own kingdoms because their technology was so high that, you know, some might say, you know, I like super tropical weather, so I'm going to settle over here. I'm going to go plop down in Brazil. You know, that looks good to me. And somebody else might say, no, I like to ski. I like the snow. I'm going, you know, Switzerland or maybe Sweden. And, you know, when we look at the Bible and Deuteronomy 32:8 and says, don't you remember the days of old? This is Moses talking before he's dying. The days of old, don't you remember your fathers and your forefathers telling them of how the Most High divvied the nations of the earth according to the number of the sons of the gods, right? Or heavenly beings. You know, again, it's all about the interpretation. That really does sound like people with advanced technology coming down and deciding, I'm going to take this area, you take that area. Okay, it's a deal.
Well, just looking at who runs this place now, you know, why would we believe that they wouldn't have done that? You know, they have every reason to think and feel that that's exactly what happened.
And so the co-author of this study says, and this is key, contrary to what many believe, neither the genetic or fossil record have so far revealed a definite time and place for the origins of our species. No matter what we're told, they're telling us straight out here, we don't know.
I know. Aren't we just so lucky they're telling us what they know? Mm-hmm.
It's fascinating to think about. So guys, we want to thank you for your support on Ko-Fi and Patreon. Make sure you guys are subscribed. Before we go, Cindy's going to take us away with a little tuning.
God bless and namaste.
God bless and namaste, guys.